Hello, and welcome to the online worship gathering of Ada Congregational Church. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, we pray that you would experience God's welcome here as we do our best to love all, welcome all, and seek justice for all. As we worship together today, we pray that you would experience God's grace and God's peace. And we hope that you can join us at 11:30 Sunday morning on the 23rd for our annual meeting, our congregational meeting on Zoom. And hopefully all of you already have that link. If not, it's in the email that you received this link for this video. Otherwise, reach out to either me or Pastor Rebecca, and we can share that Zoom link with you. We hope that you can join us. And now let's worship together.
We light these candles to remind us that Jesus is the light of the world. Please join in our responsive call to worship as the words are shared on the screen. This day is holy to the Lord your God. Let us come ready to see and hear and touch the word of God. Do not mourn or weep, and do not be grieved. How can we be troubled when we experience God's word and know God's love through our worship together? The joy of the Lord is our strength. Let us come together to worship the God of joy, strength, and love. Let us pray. O God, who gives us strength when we feel weak, we gather to hear your word, sing your songs, and give you praise. We know that you are always with us, and we are grateful. Help us to live our lives in ways that show you are near. Thank you for your presence and constant care for us in worship and in each day of our lives. Amen.
Storm my
Welcome, friends. Let's say our special Epiphany greeting. The Lord be with you and also with you. The season of Epiphany is a time to discover something new about ourselves, about God, about the world. We talk a lot about light, helping us to see these new things. I wonder what kind of lights you have at your house that light the way. Do you have a night light, perhaps? Or maybe you have a fireplace that when you make a fire, the light shines. Or maybe you have a light in your refrigerator so that every time when you open, you can find the things you're looking for. Well, at our house, we have a special light outside our front door. And actually, our nice friends, Ken and Liz from church, shared it with us because I liked theirs a lot at their house. And this light we put out in the darker seasons of the winter, and it glows a bright beam across our front door. And every time I pull into the driveway and I see that light shining on our front door, it makes me think, welcome to our house. And it gives me a little joy in my heart. That is what light does. That even though there's darkness around us, the light lifts and it shows us the way. I wonder when Jesus says, I am the light of the world, what that could mean for us. I think it means for me that when I'm having difficult times, when I'm sad or frustrated, Jesus is lighting the way, showing me the options, and telling me that he is with me to love me and care for me. I'm not alone. The light gives us hope. I hope this week that as you're walking around, you might notice some light and see where it's shining and helping you to go safely. Also, we are challenged to be light. So maybe at school, we can be helpers and to share hope with friends or with our family or even at the store or in sports. Shine the light of Jesus. May we all discover something new. Let's say our echo prayer together. Holy One, may your light shine in me. May your light shine in all creation. Amen. And I say a special blessing to all our friends, our young children friends. God made you, God loves you, and God cares for you. Amen.
Thank you. is.
Our scripture readings today come from Zechariah in the Old Testament and Luke in the New Testament. Zechariah 9:12, "Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double." Luke 4:14 through 21, "Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in the synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me. I bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor.' Then he rolled up his scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Today he began to say to them, 'Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing.'"
I have been looking forward to this day for a whole bunch of weeks. Today is our congregational meeting. And it might seem weird that that's something that someone would really look forward to, but I do. Because it's a chance for our church to come together, and to review the year that we have just had, and to preview what do we anticipate, what kind of mission and ministry do we hope to do this next year. And that has been happening all over the place in little pods and groups and committees and staff and creative worship planning and musicians and boards throughout the year. So many different people are doing so many things, but we don't always come together and just take a minute and review. And so we get to do that today, and I hope that you can join us for that annual meeting. And I'm going to take some time during this sermon to reflect on the past year. And it's been a tough year, if we can be honest. This last couple of weeks has been one of the toughest couple of weeks in my family's life, on top of 2 years of a pandemic and so much change and transition and hardship for so many of our friends and family. And I know many of you have had similar experiences. And there's been plenty of darkness, plenty of turmoil, plenty of conflict, more than we can handle sometimes. And it can be overwhelming. And yet, in Advent, we had that theme, that verse that just kept coming up from John 1, that the light shines in the darkness and the darkness will not overcome it. Moments before I recorded this sermon, I heard from an old friend, one of the kids I coached years and years ago, whose family is really struggling and had to make some significant choices about their mom this week. And then he just texted me moments ago that their pet that they've had for their whole life passed away. Literally this morning. And the pain in his life right now, and he just says, I keep hoping to find some good in all of this. What is this for? What is all this for? And I told him, I'll talk to you in a few minutes, but I have to finish recording this sermon, which is on hope in the midst of the darkness. And so I hope that this finds you wherever you are in that darkness and light and challenges and conflict and beauty. Wherever you are on that journey, we pray that you can experience God's grace and God's peace today. As I planned this sermon on hope a couple of weeks ago, our friend Ruth Wowie in a staff meeting said, "Hey, I'm reading something that might be helpful." And it turns out it was, which is almost always the case when Ruth shares something. She's reading this book, and it's by, I forget his name now. I think it's Donald Adams and Jane Goodall. And we went this summer to the museum, Field Museum in Chicago, and watched the Jane Goodall exhibit. And I was overwhelmed with the grit and the gumption that this woman had going back decades to kind of break open the doors that she wanted to go through that weren't accessible to her. And she has changed the way the world does science. She's changed the way we understand animals and humanity. And through it all, she has hope. And so Ruth shared this. The author, one of the authors, says to Jane, "Have you heard the joke about the difference between the optimist and the pessimist? The optimist thinks that this is the best of all worlds, and the pessimist is worried that he is right." And he writes, "Jane laughed and then said, 'We don't really know how it will all turn out, do we? And we can't just think that we can do nothing and that everything will work out for the best.' Jane's pragmatic view," he says, "made me think of a conversation I had with Desmond Tutu, who had endured so many tragic reversals and so much adversity in the struggle to free South Africa from the racist apartheid regime. I recalled to Jane, Archbishop Tutu once told me that optimism can quickly turn to pessimism when the circumstances change. Hope," he explained, "is a much deeper source of strength, practically unshakable." When a journalist once asked Tutu why he was optimistic, he replied, "I'm not optimistic." He replied, "I am a prisoner of hope," quoting the biblical prophet Zechariah. He said, "Hope is being able to see that there is light despite all the darkness." "Yes," Jane said, "hope does not deny all the difficulty and that the danger exists, but it is not stopped by them. There is a lot of darkness, but our actions create the light. So it seems we can shift our perspective to see the light and also work to create more of it." Jane nodded. "It is important to take action and realize that we can make a difference and that this will encourage others to take action. And then we realize that we are not alone and our cumulative actions truly make an even greater difference. That," Jane Goodall says, "is how we spread light. And this, of course, makes us all ever more hopeful." End quote. I'm thankful to Ruth for sharing that with me, and I thank you for giving me an entire minute to read a segment from that book. Because it is important to take action. And like Jane says, when we realize that we can make a difference and that that can encourage others to take action, then we realize we're not alone. That's why we've worn masks for 2 years. It's why we got vaccinated. It's why right now we're watching this video instead of gathering in this sanctuary. I would so much rather have you all here with me. I'm sick of sharing sermons into a phone. And yet, the way that we can protect and love our neighbors, the way we can care for our healthcare system, the best way that we can share the light is by maintaining a bit of distance right now, by doing our part. And hopefully it's only another week or two or three, and we'll be back together. But it's important to take action. That's how we spread light, and not just individually, but collectively. And Jane says, this, of course, makes us all ever more hopeful. And so that's what I want to focus on today. The actions of you and of me and of us over the last year that have brought more light to the world, that have brought more hope to me, and I hope to you. Because there is plenty of darkness, and we don't need to highlight it, but we also don't need to ignore it or pretend that it's not real. It's not healthy to pretend that this isn't hard, that loss and grief and trauma, we don't need to pretend that those aren't hard. But we also can't be smothered by them. And so in the midst of it, we look for light, and we look for hope, and then we act. And so I'm thankful that in the past year that I get to do ministry with a pastor as amazing as Reverend Rebecca. She's incredible, and she shares her gifts not just as a Sunday school coordinator, but as a pastor of our congregation and as a pastor of me and my family. And the gifts that she brings and creative worship planning and every single children's message that is meaningful, no matter how old you are. We shouldn't even call them children's messages anymore. I'm thankful for the gifts that Rebecca shares with our church family. And I'm thankful for the music ministry that makes our church who we are. And so many of you have shared your instruments, your talents, your voices. And Sherry and Ed bring all of that together. And what a gift that we have a congregation that doesn't put an emphasis only on perfection or performance and making everything perfect, but we value everyone's voice. And despite that, it's pretty quality, isn't it? And a lot of that is due to all of you, but immense credit in the last 2 years goes to Sherry. Because it's one thing to coordinate a choir piece live and in person and to train people and get everybody ready. It's a whole nother thing to record 20 to 30 people and then blend that together and take the hours and hours and hours to make that into a music piece. And I know that all of us have been doing a lot in our jobs and our families just to hold everything together. But I specifically want to thank Sherry for all the work that she has put into keeping our music ministry together. And I already mentioned Ruth and what a meaningful role she plays in my life. But she also manages our office and does an exceptional job. And Pam, our financial secretary, and our staff is together and yet trying to not all be in the office at the same time. We're trying to follow COVID protocols. And everything isn't always perfect, and sometimes there's typos and we make mistakes, but boy, things are staying together, and I'm thankful for each of them. And each week, Kendall used to edit our videos together, and now it's my daughter Grace, and we continue to have this online platform of worship service. We haven't missed a single week during the pandemic. And Jay Barber is getting, and the trustees are continuing to ready our live streaming technology. The electricians, I see them right now, I can see the holes that they have drilled as we get ready to be able to live stream from this space. And Terry Walker is wandering around the building trying to fix leaks and all sorts of things that are going on right now as our building ages. And he has been so faithful for so long as our building manager. And we have Wednesday night dinners. We got to do some of those this fall, and they were beautiful. And Jen Leach and her family makes that happen. And we have so many of you are on boards and councils, and Matt is our new moderator and doing a great job of helping the boards come into alignment, increasing our communication with each other and focusing on shared vision and goals. The mission board. In a pandemic, it was hard to figure out what should we be doing? How do we love our neighbor in this? And they came up with new ways, restaurant fundraisers, coat drives, so many ways that our church has been blessing those around us. Now we've sponsored a family from Afghanistan. Someone donated a laptop to give them just this week. So many things where light and hope are bursting forth through you, through us. Brian today has been our treasurer, I don't even know how many years, but he stayed on again and again until we found Steve Carlson, who stepped in this coming year. And we're so thankful for Brian and all the work that he put in over all of these years. What a gift. And the list goes on and on. We had outdoor services, and it was so much work to set all that up, and yet it was so glorious to be together over at Ada Christian School in their little amphitheater, and then in our own backyard in the fall. Our COVID team, which continues to figure out how can we keep ourselves safe and love our neighbors. A confirmation class and 4 confirmation mentors. More than a dozen kids wrestling with their faith, figuring out what does it mean to follow Christ and be part of a church, to be part of this church. And so many new folks that have found our church family online, outside, now in the building, finding us in the middle of a pandemic. What a gift. And the list goes on, and I can't name everybody. But what a gift that in this darkness, in this challenge, with everything going on around us, we hear the words of Archbishop Desmond Tutu, another great human that we lost in 2021. Went through so much darkness, more than we can probably imagine, and yet he was filled with hope. And he quoted that line from Zechariah 9 that Pastor Rebecca read a moment ago. Return to your fortresses, you prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. Zechariah tells these people who are depressed and hopeless, right, that there's no way in their circumstances that they can see something positive coming out of this. And Zechariah prophesies and calls them prisoners of hope. And Archbishop Tutu grabs onto that image, prisoners of hope. And so it's my prayer as we lean into an annual meeting, as we lean into maybe year 3 of a pandemic, there's signs that it might be coming closer to an end. There's signs that we can see that offer glimmers, and yet we know the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. And so I challenge you, prisoners of hope, lean into that light. Lean into hope. Even as our friend Ed sings an Advent song of hope. Amen. Join me in prayer. Holy and gracious God, you are our fortress. You are our hope. Come to us today. Fill us with your spirit today. Show us your light today. Comfort those who are experiencing pain and sorrow. God, there are some among us where the darkness just is overwhelming. We pray that you would show them your light, that they would see a glimmer, a flicker of what could become a flame. And then, I pray that we could gather around each other, that we could lift each other up, that together we can carry the burdens that sometimes seem too heavy on our own. And sometimes we just need to lay those burdens down. And so, God, I pray wherever each one of us, wherever we are, that you would meet us there, that you would fill us with what we need, and that collectively we could shine your light in the world, that we would be examples of your hope, that we would be your hands and feet in a hurting world. And that in this coming year, that the mission and ministry that we do, that it would glorify you, that would draw people closer to you, that it would point to your love, and that we would share that love with the world. Even as we pray together the words that Jesus taught us, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." And now, friends, as we go, may we be inspired by the same Jesus that inspired Archbishop Desmond Tutu. May we hold on to that prophecy of Zechariah, and may we be prisoners of hope. As you go into this week, friends, go in God's grace and God's peace and be filled with hope. Amen.